Divine Truth Assistance Group. Group assistance sessions putting principles of divine truth into action. This recording is from the Understanding God's Loving Laws group and is part of an Education in Love series. In the introduction presentation, Jesus introduces the Understanding God's Loving Laws assistance group, conducts a brief revision of what has been taught already in the series, and discusses why understanding God's laws is essential for an education in love. Recorded on the 18th of November 2016 in Noosaville, Queensland, Australia.
Loosen up, guys. Relax. Relax. Can you see that even when I share with you what the problem is, it's like even then there's a heightening of worry, concern, you know, and you're not just allowing yourself to feel, right? Just let yourself feel. Just let yourself feel what's going on here. Now, you're going to have plenty of opportunity to feel this week, so. Yeah. Can we have a mic down with, thanks, Monique.
If something does arise for us in the sessions and we feel like we need to feel, is it best to leave the room or that would be to, okay,
yeah.
If we have to?
Yeah, we're okay with that. You know that. You can leave and come back. That's fine. If you need to feel, you can. If you're feeling, you can go away for two or three sessions as far as we're concerned. It's when you go away for two or three sessions and you're not feeling and you're going off doing private things, that's when we're going to draw the line and say, yeah, you can't come back. If you're going away to practice what you're learning, then why would we stop you from that? Of course we wouldn't. Make sense? Yep. Okay, well, let's get to the real why we're here, huh? And if you're going to be this deadbeat while the rest of the group, I think I'm going to go home. And what I'll do is I'll make you go home and I'll stay in this nice place and go some surfing. That's what I'm going to do. Honestly, engage, guys. Let yourself stop worrying so much. Engage the process emotionally. Let yourself feel about what we talked about. Treat it seriously. But don't just shut down. Stay open. Let yourself engage. Yeah? Okay, well, I've got 4 minutes to discuss this with you, so it'll be obviously a bit longer than that, where I'm probably 15 minutes or so. It'll be over this evening. Okay. By the way, myself and Mary do not wish to keep giving you heaps of energies just so that you can avoid the fact that you're not engaging. All right? So if I find I'm doing that with you, then I'll just go, yeah, let's all go home. Does that make sense? It's not much point that. Now, for those of you who've travelled a long way to be here, that'd be disappointing, right? Yeah. So let's engage, huh? Yep. Okay, well, let's look at God's loving laws. What's our course purpose? Of course, it's God's law. God's universe operates on love. You've learnt that, but I don't know if you really could say you've learnt that, right, at this stage, could we? We've just been told that probably at this point. We don't necessarily believe it. In fact, for many of us, the true belief in our heart is this, you know, this crappy life on this crappy earth, it's just so crappy all the time. And, you know, that's probably where we feel in our heart, right? But at the end of the day, we are getting told that God's laws, God's universe operates on love. But most of us have yet to really test that, to make, you know, experiment with that to see whether it's actually true or not. But every one of God's laws, from the smallest to the greatest, obviously, affects our soul-based life, and they're all based on love. This is something we would like to share with you in this particular group. So that being the case, it makes logical sense for us to get this education in love. Now, of course, as we've learnt from this discussion, in the previous discussion I had with you about will and desire, of course, if you're not going to do anything about it, then it's not going to benefit you very much, right? But if you do something about it and you experiment with it, you'll learn whether it's true or not, obviously. Right? Now, for most of us, we still really haven't done that. We're still in this stage of going, sounds all good, but I don't reckon I can trust it. Right? For many of us, that's where we're at. We're not really trusting that it's possible. So this education, this necessity to be educated by God, comparing the world's definition of love to God's definition of love. The world's definition has led us to the pain and suffering that we currently feel. But unfortunately, because of that, we have this predisposition to think, wow, maybe that's all there is. Maybe this is all I can finish up doing, just this life as we have it, pain and suffering. But if you consider that God is good, as we've talked about in the previous groups, yes, God is good, then it makes sense that if God is good and we live in harmony with God's laws and principles, then our life will become good and therefore less pain and suffering. But unfortunately, we don't believe that. But we need to believe it to connect to God. That's our problem. So to get an education from God, we need to connect to God. To connect to God, we need to have some trust in God's goodness. And yet most of us carrying around the will is saying, nah, nothing's really good. Nothing's really possible to be good. You know, that's really the will, is it? So at this stage, we've got to experiment with desire. We've got to go, maybe God is good. How do I experiment with that? How do I develop a desire to really know that? There needs to be a shift between our current state and our new condition. Now, what we're going to suggest, obviously, is that laws are involved in the reception of God's love and the connection with God. And as you will find this week, there are billions and billions of laws that are actually involved in these things. Now, obviously, billions of laws. How are we going to get to cover billions of laws in 34 hours? Obviously, we're not going to, right? So many of you, when you first saw us release the title of this discussion, Understanding God's Loving Laws, you would have thought, oh, yeah, it's going to talk about law of attraction and law of cause and effect and, you know, law of forgiveness and repentance and laws of love and so forth. I think that's what he's going to talk about, right? And now you've seen from the outlines, you go, it's all about principles, not laws. Why is that? Well, we'll talk to you about that tomorrow. We need to really connect with what God's love is. And the only way we're going to do that is by bringing ourselves more into harmony with it, of course. And we need to release from ourselves our own concepts of love. Now, this is where our will is currently. Our will is basically saying, no, my concept of love is true. What I believe love to be is what it is. And what we're saying, well, to release false definitions of love, we've got to develop a desire to see that actually my definition of love is probably false and that something needs to change in me before I'm going to be able to experiment with that. So in the first group, we looked at developing my will to love. You remember that group? Yep. And we talked about, firstly, we talked about understanding our unlovingness, didn't we? Almost. Like that's one of the things we had to analyze where we were right now. And many of us still haven't really done that. We're not really going, wow, I do feel like I want to dominate men, or wow, I do want to accept domination just in case if I can get sex out of it, or I do want to live in fear. That's how I am. Most of us not even accepting that at this stage, right? Accepting the truth of where we're at. If we don't accept the truth of where we're at, can you see we're probably never going to develop desire to change? Now, you learnt that in the first group, but I don't see a desire to change. So this tells me that maybe you haven't learnt that in the first group. Maybe we need to go back to the first group and see, well, what's going to cause my change? It's got to be desires. It's got to be some other desire developed within me before I will change. So I have to analyse why I don't want to change. What's my resistance, facing my resistance to change? Remember, that was the second session in the first group. I've got to see why I don't want to. So here I am, I want to dominate men. Why don't I want to change that? There's got to be reasons why. If I want to accept domination for sex, for example, there must be reasons why I'm doing this. What's going on? I've got to face my resistance to changing that. See, if I just stay in that resistance to not changing that, then there's no desire to change, is there? And so therefore, change is not possible. And then we looked at using our will to develop faith. You know, remember those four things, the four tools? Yeah? Most of us still have a lot of trouble with those four tools, particularly faith. Now, you'll learn this week that faith is actually desire. They are synonymous with each other. Right? So that's an interesting concept. Developing faith, longing for truth, taking action, these are the things we learn. And dealing, being humble to our emotion. These are the key ingredients to our change. Right? So we learnt that in the Developing My Will to Love group. Then we came to the Developing My Loving Self group. Remember that one? Just a few months ago. For those of you who've only recently watched it, it's probably only a few weeks ago, right? And the first thing was we had to understand my unloving self before we could remove my unloving self. We had to understand why it's there, how it works, what's going on, what's the mechanisms behind it. Why am I like this? In other words, why is it that my will is like this, developed in the way it is currently developed? And then once we could do that, we could go, okay, if my will is currently dominating men, how do I now change? So this is about removing the unloving. So how do I remove this unloving part of me? And have, firstly, obviously, you can see you need a desire to remove it. Otherwise, it's never going to go, right? But once you've worked out the desire to remove it, how do I remove it? And we went through all these things that you can do to remove it, facing the facade, dealing with those things, start deconstructing the facade, looking at that global fear and terror and all those kind of issues. Remember? Yeah. Have you done it? See, I can't say that most of you have at this stage. Becoming my loving self. Remember there, it was really interesting because we started talking about like how we're just one half. And becoming our loving self requires connection with the other half. And it's also about sharing myself and giving myself and connecting to my real personality and nature and expressing that personality and nature in the world instead of just, you know, hiding behind curtains and trying to put a facade up that says, oh, this is how my real nature is, when really your real nature is completely different to that. And honestly, too, it's far better if you feel like dominating men to admit that you feel like dominating men than it is to cover it over and say, I'm not like that. Huh? Or if you're a man and you accept domination by women for the sake of sex, that you accept, yep, this is how I am. You know, the old saying, you know, that I'm led by my penis is pretty much the case for many of us, right? And we need to address that. Out of harmony with love, if I become my loving self, I'll look at that, I'll remove my unloving self, and I'll start looking at, okay, are my relationships dominated by sex, or am I really interested in the person here? And am I interested in being myself? And am I interested in my partner being themselves? And do I really want to know what that is? Or am I just interested in the sex? And if I don't get the sex, that's all. Throw the relationship away. Right? Is that how we are? We need to see these things. So some good questions. Am I going to be my real self? Am I going to have a relationship with God? Am I going to connect to the other half of myself? Or am I just going to keep avoiding it? Now, I'm suggesting to you, while we have intergender emotional injuries that we discussed in the previous discussion with you just before, a few minutes ago, I'm suggesting to you, you don't want to connect to the other half of yourself. So you're not even wanting to be yourself at this stage. So let's address the issue, you see. So when we come to this question now, why are we even discussing God's laws? Why do we want to discuss them? Well, the answers are pretty plain, really. The God's laws are an expression of God's love and also state God's intentions. What God wants to have happen with the universe are actually put into law. So that's an interesting concept if you think about it. God's actual emotional intentions are actually stated by the law. The laws tell us what his intentions are. So this is a way to get to know God a bit, right? To understand. See, many of us are struggling with getting to know God. We go, what's this love? Half the time we don't even know what love is. And then the other half of the time, what's God? You know, Jesus keeps talking about God's nature and personality. What's that? I don't understand. How do I find out God's nature and personality? You find out by examining the law. The laws tell you what God's nature and personality is. It's fantastic. Now, God's laws therefore educate us about what God defines love to be. So you know how we're floundering around going, I don't know what love is. I don't know, you know, I've got all these damaged concepts of love inside of me. I've got no idea what this love is. What do I do about that? Well, what you do about it is you discover more about God through the laws, and you'll find out what God's definition of love actually is. And this is what you'll do this week. That's why it's such an important group, because this group is the foundation of your understanding of a lot of things, actually. The foundation of your understanding of sin, foundation of your understanding of what it means to engage a law, the foundation of even your relationship with God, because you can't have one without engaging some law-based processes, right? So the beauty of God's laws is they educate us about God's definition of love. So instead of now going, I've got no idea what God's version of love is and I know what my version is, but I've got no idea, you know, how that differs from God. Well, now we can start to see how it differs. All right? This is the beauty of the examination. And God's laws demonstrate to us where the pain and suffering comes from, because every law has compensatory effects, which we'll learn about during the week. So this means that when we're in pain and suffering, we know we must be out of harmony with the law. All right? And can you see that can give us a lot of power. Because what we can start doing then is go, right, I'm in pain. If I could just find the laws that I'm out of harmony with, then I can get rid of this pain. That gives us power to make adjustments in our life and to remove pain from our lives. Very powerful understanding God's laws. So let's look at some of the benefits just briefly, and we'll look at them both side by side. So if we understand God's laws, understanding God becomes possible. Before then, we're sort of groping around in the dark, you know, what's God about, right? Obviously, the opposite is true if we don't understand. Now, a relationship with God becomes possible. Now, obviously, the opposite is true if we don't understand. I gain an education about love. The opposite is true if I don't understand. So can you see already just those three things mean understanding God's laws has some benefit to us. Let's go to the other benefits. My redemption and transformation becomes possible. Now, this is talking about not only my current state, in other words, removing this from my current state, this will used to sin from my current state, but not only that, but my transformation, my future potentials change. If I understand God's loving laws. And during the week, what we're hoping to do is, and hoping to achieve, is to expand your concept of your future potentials. And tomorrow we'll begin to introduce the concept of infinity to you and what that actually means for you. Right? It's powerful things to understand. If you truly get them, you'll see transformation is a huge part of understanding God's laws. I can also understand my pain, as we've already mentioned. Obviously, again, the opposite is true if we don't. Right? What else? I develop faith in God, God's goodness, and God's creations. How does that happen? Well, by understanding the laws, I start to see consistency, permanence, scope. I start seeing all the ways in which God's laws operate right across the board, right through the rest of my existence. And I can start having some feelings then about how God has planned things so cleverly and intricately just for my happiness. Which tells me that God is good. Yeah. And I gained an understanding about God's truth, because actually the law is God's truth. the law is God's truth. So I understand what God's truth is now, if I can understand the law. Obviously, the opposite is also true. I remain without faith in God if I don't understand. I don't understand God's truth because God's laws are God's truth. So if they're a large part of God's truth, what do? If I'm not understanding the law, I don't really get God's truth. I don't really get it. Huh? What else? I understand what makes me happy and others happy. And I even start to get this idea and concept that if I'm unhappy and others are happy, or others are unhappy and I'm happy, something's wrong. Right? I start to even understand that. And I have the potential to use my will positively to bring happiness. So not only do you now have an internal state of happiness, now you have the potential through what you choose to do with your life to bring happiness, more happiness to your life, and also more happiness to others. Right? If you understand the law. But obviously, if you don't understand the law, the opposite also is true. Right? So my life is no longer is governed by the highest laws now. So now that it's governed by the highest laws, the fundamental basic laws, it's like they don't exist anymore. Because I can engage higher laws. But the opposite is also true. Oops, wrong. I often do this. I'm trying to scroll this one, not this one. The opposite also true. My life is limited by fundamental laws if I don't engage understanding of the law. There are fundamental laws that are just forced upon us and we just have to engage them. That's the way it is. It's much better to engage a process through desire willingly, through the exercise of our desire, than it is to be forced through our will being a certain state into engaging a process. And we continuously benefit from it as well. And we'll give you a lot of illustrations of that over the coming weeks, of how humankind, when they discover a new law, now all of humankind can benefit from what one person discovered. It just requires one of you discovering a new law. Let's say one of you discover how to fly with just your body, let's say. Now, if you could explain that and show people that and demonstrate that to the world, don't you think a lot of other people want to do the same thing? Of course they will, right? Just one person discovering it can benefit the entire world of mankind. What a loving thing. It's like just that one principle is very interesting in itself, isn't it? God gives us 7 billion opportunities every day to discover a new law that the whole of us will benefit by having 7 billion people or more on the planet who could possibly discover a law every day. Right? These are all the advantages. So when we examine the reasons for being here, there are huge advantages of understanding these laws and principles. And so what we would like to do is use this group as an opportunity to not only demonstrate the advantages, but also to start, it will start hopefully opening your concept of God and your concept of love. And you start to see what is involved in love and what is involved, like in terms of God's nature and personality, what kind of nature God has. Yeah. So there's a lot of really good things that we can talk about through the group. Now, the issue, though, with the group is that we've got all this stuff crammed in, right? If you look at the outlines, you'll notice there's all the stuff about what it reveals about God, the objectives of the law, the definition of the law, the principles of the law and so forth. And there's a lot of other things sometimes with a lot of them, the terminologies that we've got to get used to and so forth. Now, you can see that we're not going to be able to cover most of that material, right? Because we're just not going to have the opportunity. So what we're going to do is present basically a summary of the principles and examples of the principle to help you understand how that principle works in a basic way. And during your question times, you have the opportunity, as Mary said, to write down your questions and ask intelligent questions about what does that mean? how do I understand this better, and so forth. Right? So that's hopefully what we'll be able to achieve in the group. So during the week, focus on the principles and the application of principles is what we're going to do. Now, obviously, we'll spend some time seeing how these principles can be applied in our day-to-day life as well. And in particular, we want to give you examples so that you see in practice how the principle works. We'll be discussing some of those examples. But again, the question has to be asked, well, we can learn all this week, but again, we can walk away just like we have with a lot of the other groups, just walked away and not done anything about it, right? And if we're going to do that this time, we're really just wasting a lot of people's time, aren't we? Including our own. Now, Mary and I would rather spend like 2 minutes with a person who is open to learning about love or truth than a whole week with 5,000 people who are resistive. That's how we'd rather live our life. But of course, if there were 5,000 people who were open to truth, we'd prefer to spend the whole week with them. Does that make sense? So this is your choice that you can make. Is it like, do we want to become a group of people who are just open and want to practice truth, want to practice love in our life? We're just going to get, you know, back into the talk about it and just talk about it. And a lot of times, you know, we talk because we're afraid of do. You know, we need to learn to do, not just talk. Yep. If you do, you'll get the advantages of doing. If you talk, it's just a lot of hot air, going nowhere. As Mary says in one of her presentations, talk is cheap, right? It really means nothing. Every time even that you say, oh, thanks, that was so wonderful, it's still pretty cheap, really. It's just like 5 seconds of your life where you just say that and you can walk away and completely ignore everything you just said. What's going to prove whether you really wanted to do this is putting it into action. That's what's going to prove it. So that's what we'd like to remind you to do, is to put it into action. So tomorrow, this session, obviously, that we're starting now is going to be foundation principles. We're going to discuss tomorrow 6 principles. There's actually 7 different topics we'll be discussing with you tomorrow. So you've got to be on the ball. We're changing quite frequently with these topics tomorrow. And in fact, some topics we're only spending 20 minutes on at a time. Very little time. So you want to be well prepared for tomorrow. And second thing is that the next presentation, which is a really key pivotal presentation in the morning, and that's why we put it nice and fresh in the morning for you, is about the fundamental facts. So we'd encourage you to examine that outline, and we're going to raise a lot of fundamental facts with you about understanding God's laws. So that's the end of our evening. Sorry, I'm 20 minutes over tonight because we've spent that time in the middle there discussing some emotional issues. But hopefully we'll enjoy each other's company tomorrow. And also remember that other thing about Sunday morning. The need to look at the desire here, because if we feel there's still strong desires to resist here, then we've got to start removing people who don't have the desire so that the people who are left who have a desire are free to feel their desires. So this is something we must do. Now, potentially all of you could do that by Sunday morning, or none of you. Just depends on your choices and decisions over the next day. My suggestion is to start make some different choices, different desires. Okay, thanks for your time tonight, guys, and we'll see you in the morning, 10:30 in the morning. Or remember that we'll have the doors open at 10 so that you can put your questions down. There's folders up the back that are ready to go for your questions in the morning. And just come in there and just... there'll be 5 lines or 5 different people writing at the same time. And remember, as Mary said, every folder contains every single session that you can ask a question about. And she didn't mention, but I need to mention to you, the reason why we're doing this is not just so that we can answer your questions tomorrow, but also any questions, pardon me, that are left over, myself and Mary can actually discuss in our studio. And that way we can get a lot of your questions answered as well. So be prepared for tomorrow. We'll see you at that nice lazy time of 10:30, right? Nice, get time to have an exercise in the morning, maybe even go down the beach and just a bit of tune, zone in time. Look at those desires and we'll see you at 10:30 in the morning, ready, bright and sparky, with this really strong feeling of, yes, I want to go for this, and that would be wonderful to see. And then we can discuss with you some pretty important points from there on. Thanks for your time, guys.